Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Rashmi Bachu from University of Hyderabad. Today we are going to study about the creation of harem, which is part of the module Women and History. So the harem is basically about the domestic space in the medieval kingdoms. Today we are specifically going to talk about the Mughal harem. The Mughals were somebody who took great interest in creating institutions, and the harem happened to be one of the important institutions, although so far it has been left unstudied to a great extent. In this module, we shall be discussing various aspects about the Mughal harem, especially its significance within the empire, in the formation of the empire, as well as its sustenance, the composition of the harem, the social structure and the hierarchies, the physical structure, the place where the women of the royal family were inhabiting, the role of the royal woman in the court life, which includes politics as well, the economic activities that they undertook, as well as their contribution in the overall cultural and various other aspects of the empire. So, you know, by the end of this study, I hope we to demonstrate to you the fact that the harem was much more dynamic than what was earlier thought to be, at least that is what the earlier scholars made us believe. So, let us hope that we'll be able to make this point. As far as the background to this is concerned, I mean, we are all by now aware that the Mughal Empire was established during the 16th century. This was one of the most biggest, most organized, and perhaps the most centralized empires of its time. It was a huge establishment which embodied several institutions within it. In fact, many of the institutions continue even today in some modified form. So the harem happened to be, as I said, one of the most important institutions of the empire. It was also one of the most secure places within the Mughal establishment. With regard to the origin of the term harem, or harem as it is called, is derived from Arabic language, which basically means sacred or forbidden. This term has been borrowed into many other languages from Arabic. In Turkish, for instance, the same thing is called as seraglio, whereas in Persian, the word zanana is used for the place where the woman of the royal family used to dwell. Whereas in the Mughal sources, we find several terminologies being used for the same. We find the use of harem sara, harem ga, zanana, rani vas being the most common. The Rajputs, however, called the same as zanana diodi, which is a combination of the indigenous and the Persian terms. Whereas in the official text written by Abul Fasl, the Ain-e-Akbari, the Akbarnama, he uses the term Sabistan-e-Iqbal and Sabistan-e-Khas. The terms are used to denote the institution of harem as well as the place where the woman lived. So it is used interchangeably. The main inhabitants of the harem happen to be the women, the female members of the royal family, which included the various wives of the emperor, the existing and the previous emperors, the mothers of the emperor, which included the stepmothers as well. Other than this, the foster mothers were given great importance within the Mughal culture. The sisters, daughters and cousins of the emperor also happened to inhabit this area. These people formed the first layer of the royal family and the harem in terms of importance. The Mughals were known to provide shelter to needy relatives. We find in the history of the Mughal Empire various people from royal and noble families from areas of Central Asia and Persia and other areas seeking refuge with the Mughal emperor in case of difficult situations. So they were also accordingly accommodated within the harem. So they also became inhabitants of the harem. Other than this, we find young princes being lodged in the harem quarters until they attained the age of maturity. This was important because they were required to be under the supervision of the mothers and the grandmothers. So they needed to be educated in a particular way in order to for them to be able to take over the reins of the empire. So other than this, I mean, of course, the emperor was the most important inhabitant. He also had a quarters within the harem. Other than this, we do not find any outside men being allowed within the harem. This was very important and closely guarded issue. With regard to, the composition of the harem has been a subject of great debate amongst the scholars through different generations. The main source, I mean, this also happens to be the problem because we do not find many sources talking about the woman or about the harem itself. In the Mughal sources, official texts, it was considered to be derogatory to mention in any information regarding the women of the royal family. They were supposed to be very sacred, and as I said, they were forbidden the outside men. Therefore, nobody had access to the harem, and the information, the actual real information, did not pass through the harem into the outside world. The main source for this particular subject comes to us through the East India Company records recorded by the factors of those time. But we need to remember that in the 16th century as well as the 17th century, these factors were not important elements within the economy and the culture of India, and they did not have direct access to the royal court. So whatever information that they give us comes through what is called as the bazaar gossip, that is whatever information was available in the public places, in the market areas, and that was grasped by these men and recorded accordingly. So what we have here is not actual information, but some kind of gossipy information which we cannot naturally rely upon. Other than this, within the Mughal sources, as I said, that official texts don't talk about the women in great detail. In fact, in most of the times, they don't even mention the names of the wives or the mothers and the daughters of the emperor. However, we do get a window into the Mughal domestic life through certain sources. For instance, Gulbadan Begum's Humayunama. Gulbadan Begum was daughter of Humayun and sister to Akbar, and she had great access to, I mean, being part of the harem, she had access to whatever was happening within the harem quarters, especially during Babur and Humayun's time. And we do get some information about the early reign of Akbar, but beyond that we do not, I mean, this kind of source for the further emperor's reigns is not available for us. Babur's Tuzuke Baburi and Jahangir's Jahangir Nama also gives us some information regarding the happenings within the domestic space of the Mughals. All right, now let us take a more detailed look at the composition within the harem. To say the least, the Mughal harem was heterogeneous in character. This was also because of the fact that the Mughal empire itself was heterogeneous. Since the time of Akbar and even before that, the Mughal emperors married into several different ethnic families and different cultural families. So that kind of allowed these women to come into the domestic space of the Mughals, and along with them they brought their own culture, their own language, food, so on and so forth. So this kind of made the Mughal harem a very heterogeneous kind of composition as well. I already mentioned the main members of the harem. Besides these respected members of the family, the harem also consisted of the concubines of the emperor. The dancing and the singing girls seems to have been present throughout the Mughal times, and the servants and the slave girls who were meant to serve the more respectable members of the family. And the women officials and security guards were also important components of the inhabitants of the harem. The eunuchs were also part of the harem. They had access to the harem because they were used as guards and as soldiers to secure the harem. We also find the mention of fortune tellers being brought within the harem. They were considered as great entertainment for the ladies So they were welcomed within the quarters. With regard to the size of the harem, we find that during the earlier times, during time of Babur and Humayun, the size was very modest. Obviously, because of the nature of the kingdom, during Babur's as well as Humayun's time, the Mughal Empire was constantly on the move. There was no fixed geographical location. Babur came from Fargana and then he established himself in Afghanistan. From there, he came to Delhi, that is North India. And Humayun, of course, he lost his kingdom, so he had to go back to Iran, Afghanistan, and he kept roaming around. So that did not allow the Mughals to have a constant harem as such. Obviously, the size also was small because they could not maintain a large harem as such. This was something which changed during the time of Akbar. Akbar was able to establish a more settled kingdom. And in addition to this, he also began to expand his kingdom. And we know that he forged marital as well as political alliances with various kingdoms of India. And accordingly, we find that, the size of the harem also became much bigger. And we also find, major changes in the rituals associated with the harem. It became more elaborate, the rituals and the culture of the harem. According to Abul Fazl, there were supposedly some 5,000 women residing in Akbar's harem. Obviously, not all of them were his wives. As I said, there were so many other important members. This is important because the earlier writers, as I said, the earlier historians as well, believing in the bazaar gossip of the East India Company records, they wanted people to believe that the harem was a place where the emperor had his wives and the concubines and so on and so forth. However, getting on with the present our concern, Jahangir, on the other hand, is said to have had 300 wives residing in the harem, and there were something around 1,000 women present in his family. Now, with regard to the social structure of the harem, the emperor, of course, was the center of attention. He, as I said, resided within the harem quarters, and everybody who wanted to become important or gain certain social status had to attract his attention. Of course, there was an internal hierarchy amongst the people residing within the harem. The mother of the emperor was considered to be the most important woman. She was consulted on all important political as well as family issues, and she had considerable influence at the royal court as well. Her importance can also be gauged by the fact that it was, she first who was visited by the emperors on his birthdays and on festivals, and also immediately after his coronation. And we also find mention in Babarnama especially, where the emperor would wait upon his mother when she went came back from traveling. Considerable importance was also accorded to the foster mothers. Now, this is part of the Chagatai Timurid culture that the Mughals followed, the Central Asian culture, where the mother was not always available to the royal princes. So, they were given to the care of the wives of important nobles who looked after the child. So, they were considered as foster mothers. They even breastfed the princes and looked after them. They were given the same status as the mother herself. Perhaps the best example of this is Mahamanga. Mahamanga was the foster mother of Akbar. Although he had three other foster mothers, Mahamanga was considered to be very important because she put her life at risk to save the infant Akbar in those turbulent times. So they were given, as I said, very important place, and Mahamanga then, went on to become the prime minister of Akbar in his early reign. Next to foster mothers came the wives. As I said, an emperor, a Mughal emperor, took several wives from different ethnic and class backgrounds. And obviously, not all of them could be given the same kind of importance or same social status. So, you know, the amount of influence they exerted within the harem structure depended upon the importance their natal families or kingdoms had within the Mughal structure. So, you know, women from, say, Rajput, Turani and Irani families, which were considered important noble families, they enjoyed higher social status, whereas women from lesser families were accorded a lower status. There were also, you know, princesses who were taken as wives from the defeated kingdoms. Once the king defeats a kingdom, he would take the princesses as his wives, and they were referred to by particular names like Mahals and Bais. So that distinction was made between important queens and the lesser queens. However, there was one cliche here. It was possible for any woman, whatsoever her status might be within the harem, to rise above her status through attracting the emperor's affection. If the emperor happened to have a liking for a particular woman, she automatically became important within the harem structure as well. Now let us get on with the next section, that is the administration and the security of the harem. The Mughals, of course, ensured that the harem is administered effectively and it was secured. As I said, the harem was the most secure place in the whole of the Mughal Empire. They were also very keen that the necessities of the inmates were well taken care of. The staff consisted, as I said, of only women. No outside men were allowed inside. This staff, the administrative staff, was divided into three categories: the high, middle and the lower strata. The internal administration of the harem was under the charge of a particular woman official known by the name of Daroga. She was directly appointed by the emperor, and she had to be somebody who was well qualified, who was intelligent and who was capable. And most of the time she happened to invariably belong to high noble families. The importance of this post can be gauged by the fact that Noor Jahan's mother, Asmat Banu Begum, is known to have occupied this post for a long time during Jahangir's reign. And in Jahangirnama, we find the emperor praising this woman for her efficiency. The prime duty of this officer was, of course, to keep the harem in order. And she had several officers under her supervision. They were known as Mahaldars. They acted as supervisors, and their main duty involved, as I said, was to keep everything in order and also keep an eye on the inmates, just to have an idea as to who was doing what. There were again different groups of supervisors meant to do particular activities. There were also supervisors for singing and dancing girls. So their activities came under the scan of a particular group of supervisors. There was also, you know, more mundane staff like the tahvildars, and they were the accounts in charges, and the ashrafs or storekeepers. These were also important offices because all women inhabitants of the harem got allowances from the emperor, but this can be accessed only through the accounts in charge, the tahvildar. So he, this particular office became important. As far as the security of the harem is concerned, there were again three circles of security. The innermost circle consisted of the Habshis, the Urdubegis and Tartar women. They were considered to be very good soldiers. And they used bows and arrows as well as short daggers to undertake their duties. These women were again divided into different groups guarding different sections of the harem, and the most efficient group amongst them were responsible for the security of the emperor's chambers. The second layer consisted of most trustworthy eunuchs in the empire, and they were referred to by the name of Khwaja Sara. The head of this group was given a title which is either Aitmad Khan or Aitbar Khan. The third layer consisted of Rajput soldiers, generally those who were in the employment of very high nobles, and these soldiers were posted at a considerable distance from the harem on the outside. And other than this, we also find on the four directions of the harem important nobles as well as ahadi, the standing soldiers of the army, were kept at a distance so as to assist the security of the harem. With regard to the physical structure of the harem, we find that the Mughal women, just like everything, Mughal, they were living amidst great beauty and luxury. The Mughals were known for their grandeur. So all their buildings, all even the monuments that we see today are huge, they are grand. So the harem buildings were no different from any other Mughal building. Many of these buildings were made of marble, and it had gold engravings and gems studded within it. Persian carpets covered the floor, and we find remains of a very beautiful decoration of mirrors, chandeliers and lamps which might have adorned the living quarters. Gardens and waterfalls were again the hallmark of the Mughal living complexes. The harem itself was a fort complex which was divided into different quarters known as mahals, or more officially as Shabistan-e-Iqbal or Shabistan-e-Khas. The position an inmate had within the social hierarchy also decided which part of the harem she resided in, the residential area. Needless to say, not all inmates had a mahal reserved for them. Generally, a mahal consisted of a space meant for the royal lady's retinue, which included her slaves, her servants, the singing and the dancing girls as well. Other than this, the servants and the slaves too lived within the precincts of the harem, and the place where they lived was referred to as chowk. The concubines also similarly had separate quarters for themselves, and these quarters were known by the names of the days, the weekdays when the emperor visited them. So, we have examples like the Aitwar and the Shanivar areas. So possibly the emperor visited them on Sundays and Saturdays. And these are some of the pictures of what remains of the Mughal harem. And this is Rang Mahal, which is inside the Red Fort. This is the inner areas of the Rang Mahal. The jalis we can see here. These are the women quarters at Fatehpur Sikri. This is the marble decoration that I was earlier referring to. Now let us get on to the next section, that is the court politics. As I said at the beginning itself, contrary to popular imagination, women in the Mughal Empire were very much an integral part of the court politics. The mothers and the sisters were especially important because they played a decisive role in determining the political status of their sons and the brothers, and they were particularly important during the wars of succession. The prince they were supporting invariably went on to become the emperor. So, women participation in the court politics was perhaps more enhanced in the earlier period, that is Babur and Humayun's reign. Because of the fact that, in order to help the Mughal Empire survive, more than battles and wars, negotiations were used, and it is in this case we find the women fulfilling the role effectively. And most of the time, if you look at the history of Central Asia, all the contenders to the throne happened to be from within the families. So in that case the women were familiar with all concerned members, and being part of the family they could undertake these negotiations very effectively. Other than this, we also find, in the later period also, the women were particularly influential, in begetting forgiveness from the emperor for the erring nobles and princesses. Many a times we see either very high nobles or princes rebelling against the emperor. Which could be thwarted, the attempts could be thwarted with the help of the women of the family. They were also used as a channel by the nobles as well as common people in getting allotment of land grants land grants most of the time were made at the request of the mothers or the wives and so on and so forth. The official appointments also to a considerable extent, influenced by the women. And granting of Mansabdari ranks was also something which the women meddled with. They were particularly influential in these areas. Prominent amongst them were Akbar's mother. She had influence over Akbar in these issues. Mumtaz Mahal Shahjahan's wife also had considerable influence. His daughter Jahanara also played a very important role both during Shahjahan's reign as well as Aurangzeb's reign in these issues. So other than this, we also find some women like Noor Jahan and Mumtaz Mahal had authority to issue royal orders like parwanas and hukums. These parwanas and hukums were generally issued by the royal princes and not princesses. So we can see that they were given a similar status within the empire. Other than this, we also find that the royal seals were always kept in the custody of the chief queen or the queen mother. This means that whatever orders were issued by the emperor, that had to go through the royal harem. So the queen mother and the chief queen had all the knowledge about whatever was happening officially across the empire. This is one painting of the elder woman of the harem. This is of course Jahangir and Noor Jahan. These are the coins bearing Noor Jahan's name. This is one example of how important Noor Jahan was in the court activities. This is Mumtaz Mahal. Right now we'll come to the most important perhaps section of the paper, and that is the economic activities. As I said, women took part in not only the mundane domestic activities but the more into the public sphere also, although they were not visible. With regard to the economic activities, the Mughal women extensively took part in mercantile activities. It is said that Jahangir's mother owned a fleet of ships plying en route to Mecca. She also happened to send a number of people on pilgrimage to Hajj through her ships. The largest of this fleet was named Rahimi and it plied between West Asia and Persian Gulf. Noor Jahan again was a patron of European East India companies. They had direct dealings with her and she invested in merchandise of both Portuguese as well as the English East India Company. And she is known to have regularly paid cartages to the Portuguese, the passes that the Portuguese issued in order to undertake overseas mercantile activities. Her friendship with the English is also well recorded. It seems that in 1627 she granted an order exempting the English company from paying transit duties. The English ambassador Thomas Rowe also in his diary he refers to Noor Jahan as his solicitor and he is full of admiration for her abilities. Jahanara is another Mughal lady who is recorded to have heavily invested in overseas trade. She had ships named Sahibi and Ganjwar through which she traded with the ports of West Asia and Persian Gulf. In addition, to the overseas trade, we also find engagements of these women in domestic trade also. And the jagirs were also granted to these women, which contributed towards their income, which obviously happened to be huge. As I mentioned earlier, generally all royal and dependent women within the harem were given maintenance or allowances. And in addition to this, certain influential and important women were given cash presents as well. This happened on important festivals like on Eid and Diwali. They were given huge cash presents. Noor Jahan was known to have been bestowed with large jagirs in areas like Toda near Ajmer and Bharuch and Surat in Gujarat. These areas were considered to be very fertile and they yielded a large amount of income to its holders. Jahanara too had huge jagirs within the Mughal Empire. As we have been seeing, they had access to huge amounts of money, they had huge income, but we need to understand that they did not just waste away all the money that they got. The Mughal women were also known for their charitable activities. The most important activity that they undertook perhaps happened to be the public construction works. These were mostly in the form of mosques, the building of the mosque, the tombs, as well as Eidgahs in various towns. Humayun's wife Bega Begum is known to have built his tomb, the Humayun's tomb, whereas Nur Jahan built around three tombs, that of Jahangir, that of her father Itmaduddaula, and of herself. And she also laid several gardens. Again, Jahanara is credited with construction of many sarais or the inns, markets, as well as two mosques. Mahamanga is also known to have built two mosques herself. In addition to these construction works, we also find these Mughal women patronizing several karkhanas or factories which manufactured luxury goods. Which were required by the royal court. So these happened to be, manufacture of luxury textiles, different kinds of textiles, and the preparing of jewelry and perfumes, so on and so forth. So other than this, they also are known to have financed the education of the orphans and marriage of young girls who could not afford this. Nur Jahan was particularly known in this category. This is the picture of Humayun's tomb built by Bega Begum. This is Khairul Majlis, the mosque built by Mahamanga. Lastly, the cultural activities are something which was an integral part of the Mughal harem. As I said, festivals were celebrated within the Mughal harem. All festivals of the major religions of those times were celebrated. That included the Eid, the Diwali, the Sehra, Holi. Holi was celebrated with great fervor. Christmas and Nowruz were also important. And all the rituals related to these festivals were undertaken by the emperor and his family. In addition, we also find regular fairs and bazaars being held within the precincts of the harem complex. Since the Mughal women could not go out, they allowed others to come inside and, buy whatever they wanted to. Singing and dancing was the most common form of entertainment for the women of the harem. In fact, we find that the Mughal emperors, whenever they were happy, they gifted singing and dancing girls to their wives and to their mothers. And even amongst the women, they gifted singing and dancing girls to each other. So this was, as I said, a very important part of the cultural life. Other than this, we also find several royal women, they were very accomplished in writing prose as well as poetry. Jahanara herself is known to have composed several religious texts related to the Qadri Sufi order, and several of them also maintained huge libraries. So learning was also part of their everyday life. So this is something which we find very interesting in the harem, Mughal harem. These are some of the pictures of the cultural life. This is the singing or entertaining the emperor. So in conclusion, now we can say that, as I said earlier, the Mughal harem was so much more dynamic, as we have seen through the lecture. Although it has been a subject of much debate amongst the scholars, within the sources we find some scholars painting the harem as a place where the emperor would gratify his sexual pleasures, whereas some others saw it as a beautiful prison where the women of the family were imprisoned forever and there was no getting out. However, as we have come to understand in the recent times, the inhabitants of the Mughal harem were not ignorant of the outside world, although they did not go out as much as they perhaps would have liked to, but they had access to the outside world, and they had connection with the outside world, and they could undertake activities which were generally not possible if they were completely cut off from the rest of the world. So as these women participated enthusiastically in the various activities, the political, the economic and the cultural activities of their times, and they were also very influential women, very capable women who could influence the decision of the emperors to a great extent, and also change the course of history in some cases. So as I said, the Mughal harem happened to be much more dynamic than what we understood. So with this, I end my lecture. Thank you very much, and thanks for watching EPG Pathshala. Thank you.